Hi friends, I hope you're having a wonderful day. Today we're going to be talking about some different tulip diseases and viruses, and I'm going to be sharing with you some real life examples of these diseases and viruses in my garden, what it looks like when the plant is trying to bloom with these diseases, what the bloom looks like if it has the virus, and also what the bulb looks like if it's infected with something like Fusarium. Now, before we dive into all these diseases and viruses, let me first share with you my growing conditions, because that does play a big factor into how prevalent some of these diseases can be in your garden. So I garden in what's now considered a zone 7A. That's not really that important. What's important is that I get a lot of constant rainfall in this area, and it's a very high humidity. So that really creates the perfect environment for fungal disease to thrive and explode quickly. So here we have our first disease, tulip fire. Isn't it lovely? But what happens when you have tulip fire, which is caused by the fungus Botrytis tulipae, is that a number of things are going to happen to both the leaves and the flower, and you will know without a shadow of a doubt that you have tulip fire. When the leaves of a tulip that's infected with Botrytis tulipae come out, they might be contorted, they might be twisted, and they may just wither away to nothing. Now, leaves that do emerge and become full-size leaves are going to have these lesions on them, is the way that I like to describe them. Sometimes they're small, oval, light brown lesions with a dark brown lining around them. And what happens is when it rains or in times of really high humidity, these lesions kind of explode and grow. Let me find a leaf like that. And so here's some examples close up. Can you see the smaller dots there on the top? And it kind of grows into larger lesions like this. You can see that these ones are really badly infected by Botrytis tulipae. And here's a really great example. You can almost see there how the lesion started. And then as it got more rain and the humidity got higher, you can see how it grew. And so it basically looks like the tulip leaves have caught on fire. What happens to the blooms? Now all these blooms have withered away, but I know I have some video I can show you. The blooms will be speckled also with those lesions. The lesion colors on the blooms, I guess I'm always growing more saturated colors generally, so the color of the lesions is kind of a light yellow to light brown, but once again, you'll definitely know you have it. This is actually fairly mild when it comes to tulip fire. In the past, when it has been really rainy and really high humidity, what will happen is that a gray mycelial mat will basically form over the bloom heads, sometimes kind of cover the petals also. And then that fungus is basically able to overwinter in plant debris, in the soil, basically in any of this surrounding area. So what I need to do is basically get all of this out of my garden, get the plants out of the garden, get the bulbs out of the garden, and then not plant tulips in this area for 3 years. So let's go ahead and do that. So now that I know without a shadow of a doubt that basically all of these tulips are infected with tulip fire, I want to go ahead and remove the plant, remove the bulb, throw it away like we just talked about. So let's go ahead and do that now. So I like to use a pitchfork just to kind of loosen around the bulbs. That way I'm not pulling any tulips up and not getting the bulb. I want to make sure I get the bulb also and get rid of this fungus once and for all. These bulbs did not come in infected because I have a few hundred more in other locations that have absolutely no sign of tulip fire. So in this case, I know I had that overwintered fungus, which has a different name. I'll put it on the screen. It's kind of like the resting stage of the fungus. I had that here from a previous year, but you can also receive infected bulbs. And I will link an article from Cornell University where they show what a bulb looks like that is infected with Botrytis tulipae, because there are some telltale signs, and I'll make sure I get you that information. So living in a climate with high humidity and lots of consistent rainfall, I've had to adapt a lot of things I read to my particular climate. You'll often hear that cut flower tulips planted as annuals for the purpose of cutting and selling, can be planted very close together, like eggs in a carton. Well, over the last 2 years, I've been experimenting with leaving room for two bulbs in between the bulb to basically try and avoid this situation in my raised beds. And I haven't had any problems with fungal disease in those raised beds. So I think that's a really good lesson on adapting information based on, oh no, I didn't get the bulb on that one. Based on your needs and your climate and just making adjustments as you see fit. I like to wear disposable gloves when I do this and dispose of the gloves immediately after getting rid of all of the botrytis from this area. Also, I'm going to sterilize my pitchfork, and it might be tempting to maybe come through and use your clippers to maybe snip the heads off. Maybe you're deadheading and you just deadhead a few. I wouldn't even do that. If you have tulip fire and you live in an environment like me, basically, once you see them, get them out of the garden, and whatever tool you touch them with, including your hands, wash them afterwards. So now that we've talked about a tulip disease that is pretty devastating, let's talk about one that's a little more interesting. This one's a virus, and I have an example of it over in the raised bed. So I'll meet you over there. So right here, we have tulip breaking virus. I have a bed here of ivory Floridale tulips, and I have two here in the front, which look quite different. It's very obvious that they have tulip breaking virus, and this is a virus that is mainly spread by aphids, but it can also be spread mechanically. You could have a tulip that has breaking virus, cut it, then cut a perfectly healthy tulip that's not infected, and therefore then cause that infection. Now the nice thing about tulip breaking virus is that it's not going to cause death to the mother bulb that you receive. What you're going to see is just stripes, flecks, or feathering of a different color on the flower petals. So right, these are all supposed to be ivory Floridale. These two obviously look totally different. So that's what happens to the bloom itself. You'll also notice that if a tulip bulb has tulip breaking virus, it won't be quite as vigorous. You see how these are a little bit shorter? The stems are weaker. And underground, the bulb itself is going to struggle to put on offsets or bulbils. So it's really hard to kind of reproduce bulbs from a bulb that is infected with tulip breaking virus. And the ones that we see on the market now that have stripes or flames, they're bred to be like that. It's not like this, where this is a virus. What's going to happen, since this didn't put on a lot of offsets, is that it's going to struggle to reproduce at all next season from those offsets. And what can happen too is if I just leave these here and I have more aphids come in and basically take from this tulip and then go to another tulip, I can cause infection all over my property. That might not be a huge deal to everyone, but if you have a collection or special tulips, that's probably not something that I would want to allow to happen. So in that case, I would just remove these tulips from my garden. So friends, now let's talk about a disease called Fusarium. Now I believe the common name for this is tulip basal rot. I've always just called it Fusarium. That's the name of the fungus that's doing the damage to these tulips. And I've had this, I think maybe 3 times in the past. But the nice thing about Fusarium is that it's pretty easy to identify on the bulbs. So I don't have any examples of the plants, but we'll talk about that too. But I'll show you a picture from my supplier back in October. I got a shipment of ivory Floridale bulbs that were obviously infected with Fusarium. And Fusarium generally happens in the field, and then it kind of continues during post-harvest storage. It can spread really rapidly, especially in storage and during periods of high humidity. So bulbs infected with Fusarium will have brown spots, and then you'll also see white and pink fungal markings on the bulbs. What also can happen is this crazy phenomena, which I have seen in a picture that someone sent me, and it's called, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, gummosis. But you're going to see those classic Fusarium marks on the bulb, but then gummosis is going to occur, and basically that can happen inside the bulb or on the exterior of the bulb, and it almost looks like this honey-like, gel-like substance that's oozing out of the bulb. I'll try to find a royalty-free picture and show you that on the screen. But if you see anything like that, you definitely have fusarium. You definitely do not want to plant those bulbs. The flowers are more than likely going to abort. One other thing I've noticed about bulbs that have fusarium over the years is that the bulbs will be quite light, almost as if they've dry rotted inside, and they'll also start to emit a foul, sour odor. They'll smell sour, they'll smell bad. You'll open the bag, you'll see the fusarium, the bulbs will be light, and you'll smell something eggy and like bad sour cream. That's what they smell like. So once again, if you see anything like that, take a picture of all the bulbs, contact the supplier, get your money back, or get new bulbs sent to you, and just dispose of those bulbs that have the fusarium. Now, there's more tulip diseases and viruses that we could talk about. My experience is that the diseases have more negative effects than the viruses do, but I am growing on a small commercial scale, very small. I would consider myself a micro farm, but I also need my tulips to look good, because part of the way I make my living is by growing tulips, growing all different kinds of bulbs, and then writing about them. That's my main source of income. So I really want to make sure I'm planting only healthy bulbs in the ground, and that I know what to look for when it comes to disease on the bulb, disease on the plant, and viruses that might pop up in my garden. So friends, I really hope this video was helpful. If it was, would you consider helping me out? Share this video with a friend, give it a like, leave a comment. Any questions or concerns that you have about tulip diseases or viruses, let me know. We can cover more in an upcoming video. But for now, I want to wish you a wonderful day and happy gardening. I almost said happy tulip fire. That's not happy at all. Bye.